Go back to alcohol. Holy shit. Welcome back to another video. Today we're going to be looking at the defensive line rankings for our updated rankings. I know it's taken a while. Me and Pussy have some very busy schedules, to say the least. You know, I'm over here kissing men. Pussy's over here kissing boys. You name it. We're doing fun things. Would you like to introduce yourself again, Pussy?
Yep, it's Trevor here, Pussy, and let's get this done.
All right. Coming in at my number 12 spot, I had J-Bay. Who did you have?
Yeah, J-Bay.
You know, should we just skip over it? He doesn't even have anyone starting. Yeah. All right. Yeah,
J-Bay. He's got people starting that just don't play.
Yeah, they're not. I don't even think they're in the NFL anymore. I think they're all actually not active at this point.
They're all in the practice squad.
Yeah. at the number 11 spot is where I actually had Justin Likes Kids.
Me too.
Oh, look at us. We're already agreeing.
Yes, sir.
To kick things off, he has Chris Jones, who right off the bat is a solid option. I don't have a problem with Chris Jones. He's been doing pretty consistent all season. Keep in mind, he did miss week one, so bear with him there. He's been a bit inconsistent over these past 3 weeks, but overall, I do think he'll go back to normal. He's one of the better defensive linemen you can have in fantasy, in my opinion. But it's the other guy that kind of makes this whole D-line fall apart. Then you get to Greg Russo, and yeah. He had those two good games at the beginning of the season, and he's just kind of been ass other than that since. It's not a horrible D-line, but compared to the rest of the league, they just kind of suck.
Yeah, Greg Rousseau's just not done much since, what was it, like week three? Mm-hmm. And then Chris Jones, not only has he kind of not done a whole lot in comparison to a lot of these guys, but also he's got a super tough schedule the rest of the season.
Oh, yeah. I noticed that, too, with the offensive lines they're going against. It's going to be ridiculous for Russo, specifically.
Yeah.
Coming in at the number 10 spot is where I had MILF.
I had Rick Tatership here.
Oh, man.
Oh, man.
All right, I guess we can kick things off with MILF. MILF has Jeff Simmons and Jonathan Greenyard. Jonathan Greenyard is actually one of the higher scoring D linemen in all of fantasy, at least especially that was on free agency. There's definitely guys that are better than him, but my problem with him is he's all over the fucking place. He can go from getting 2 points or 4 points to getting like 27 points. You don't know what you're going to get out of this guy. And I'm not a fan of that, you know, because you could just go from weeks of getting absolutely nothing and him blatantly losing you games to him doing really well. I'm not a fan of that type of player. I don't like starting players like that. Granted, I have Calvin Ridley, but that's another story. but I'm just not a fan of guys like that. And Jeff Simmons has been a bit more consistent, but he doesn't have that same upside outside of the week against Atlanta. He has had a few good games at the start of the season, but outside of four weeks out of the entire season, he's just been ass, to say the least, and he's had a long stretch of not doing much. He's been a little bit better over these past 3 weeks, but I don't think I could really rank that any higher, though. I just think that these guys are overall boomer bust players for the both of them, and I do think it's overall better than Greg Russo, who's pretty much promised to do nothing every game, and Chris Jones. That's why I had it ranked above B-Dog, but I don't think I could have personally ranked it any higher, though.
Yeah, I had him ranked a little bit higher. I like Simmons. Him and Danico Autry are a pretty good duo to have, but Greenyard, I like Greenyard just because he has those high upside games. But he is also, I think he's on the Houston Texans, and he's fighting with Anderson Jr. this year. So that's why it's kind of give and take. It's like a Wilkins and Sealer kind of situation where one's going to do good and the other one's probably not. But I had him ranked just a little bit higher just because of the production they've had this year.
Gotcha.
Plus, I like the rest of their season, the way it's looking. They don't have too hard of a season going the rest of the way. Whereas I have Rick Tatership with Pay and Autry, and they have a little bit of a tougher season ahead of them.
Well, with dictatorship and all that, we'll talk things off here. He pretty much has Danico Autry, who, if you compare him, let's say, to Jeff Simmons on MILF, he does seem like the more consistent option out of the two. Maybe he doesn't have that ridiculous upside, but he is getting a lot more tackles per game. He's finding a way to occasionally get those sacks. I do think he's more reliable overall, and this is my preferred type of defensive lineman. Because, yeah, with defensive linemen, if you don't have a certain group of people, they're probably just going to either be boom or bust. And I'm not really a fan of that because it's very too hard to rely on for a reliable starter. With that, and Danico Autry, probably he's going to have the same schedule as Jeff Simmons. He's just more of a tackler, while Simmons is more of a sack or bust kind of guy. And then you have Kwity Paye, who in the games that he's been healthy has been great, but the motherfucker is probably more injury prone than fucking spaghetti noodles before they're cooked. It's ridiculous. He had the first 3 weeks did great, got hurt for 2 weeks. And I will say against Jacksonville, I don't know if you're aware of this, where he only had 2 points. He was playing through an injury and only played a very limited number of snaps. He came back against the Saints and he had a pretty good week there. And then he did fall off against Carolina, and he did have those 9.5 points against the Patriots. And then he got hurt again, but at least he has a bye week this time. And here's the thing. I know that the schedule is saying that he might have a tougher schedule, but the thing is, outside of Atlanta, and even then, all of these teams have something in common, and that's the fact that even though their O-lines have some good pieces, none of them have a good right tackle, which is what Kwity Paye would be going against. For example, the Raiders have a really good left tackle. He would be going up against Jeff Simmons, or not Jeff Simmons, trying to think what the other guy's name is in Houston at this point, because it used to be Yannick Ngakoue. I can't remember the other defensive end's name off the top of my head, but Colton Miller would be focused on him instead of Kwity Paye. So Kwity Paye will probably have some pretty good weeks in these upcoming weeks, in my opinion. And I don't think he – oh, yeah, he cut Samson Ebukam since we were making this list, but I don't really have to mention that. Is there anything you would like to add to those players?
No.
Alrighty. Moving on to my number 10, I had Karen's husband.
And then I had, this is number 9, not number 10.
Yeah, this is number 9.
Yeah, you said 10. You had me confused for a second. This might come as a shocker here, but I have Booty here.
Oh, man, he is the National Guard, though.
Don't feel too bad. Yeah, I know. He's got fucking 61. He has fucking 60 linemen, and four of them are almost, or three of them are useless. Two of them are
Yeah. I am with Booty. I think the main thing that pushed me a little over Karen is both Karen and Booty just are forming the fucking Avengers of the defensive line. Unfortunately, the Avengers are shit. You know, the Avengers in this universe just can't do anything right. I did put Booty a little higher, because I'm thinking of it as who has the best two out of their combos, you know what I mean? Because the best two are pretty much
the third one.
So, Carl Granderson, for most part this season, has been pretty solid. He had those 2 bad weeks against the Buccaneers and against the Packers, and then he had this bad week previously against the Vikings. Other than that, he's actually been pretty damn good this season, and I'm actually going to give Booty some credit for that. But after that is kind of where Booty's D-line kind of falls off, at least for me. Sure, you have your... I'm not even going to fucking mention Taylor. He's terrible. Then you have where things get a little bit better. Josh Sweat is okay. He's kind of boom or bust, but he has been doing a lot better over these previous few weeks. But I'm fully expecting that to kind of drop off. I don't know why, but for whatever reason, every season, Josh Sweat just decides to stop playing football in between different time periods and start doing good again at different times. And then Aaron Donald has been kind of like your... Jonathan Greenyard, where he's had, 3 bad games, and then the rest have been okay to good games. I do think Aaron Donald at this point is a pretty reliable starter, and I do think he's at least okay enough to warrant him above Karen's husband, at least for me. But I didn't want to really rank him above the other guys, just because I do think the other guys have more consistency overall, outside of maybe Carl Granderson, who's looked like a beast this season.
Yeah, I really like Granderson, but that's about it on this list. I'm not a huge fan of either Donald or Sweat personally, but that's just because they're kind of mid, and they just consistently stay at mid for me. And then the other three guys aren't even worth mentioning at this point. Fucking Huff had 0 points yesterday. So But who'd you have? You had Karen's husband here.
Yeah, I had Karen. He actually played against Booty, so I really don't have to switch.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Karen, I had him a bit lower than Booty, just one spot. I do really like Quinnen Williams, and he's in a really stupid situation where I keep mentioning it in my videos. If anybody watches Jets games, I think you watched it last night, you said. You can watch. It's kind of ridiculous how much attention they give Quinnen Williams. Like, you can see teams go upwards of three people on him at once. It's kind of fucking insane. He's basically like the new Aaron Donald. You know, I'm not saying he's better than Aaron Donald was in his prime, but whenever Aaron Donald started getting good and people started catching on to it, every motherfucker on that O-line was blocking Aaron Donald, and that's kind of what you're seeing with Quinnen Williams. And it's what you see week in and week out, where he might be doing bad in fantasy, but in real life, you'll look at the rest of his defensive line, and like everybody else on that D-line will have a sack because of everything he's doing. Fantastic player in real life. I just don't think he can really get it done in fantasy. And yeah, in fact, I actually recommended Rictatorship probably try to find a new defensive line a few weeks ago. And then Karen's husband also has Uso Diggy's duo, but I don't really think he's been anything great. He had two good weeks. Other than that, he's been ass, to say the least. Let's see here. Who else did Karen's husband have? Karen also had Christian Wilkins, who was a pretty solid option. He did horrible at the beginning of the season, but he's kind of picked things up over these last 4 weeks. He is on this upcoming bye, and he does have a nice schedule coming forward when it comes to playing the Raiders, the Commanders, the Jets, all teams with horrible offensive lines, the Titans. But once you get to the final two games of the playoffs, playing against the Cowboys and the Ravens, that's not going to be too fun for a defensive lineman, though, when it comes to fantasy, unless he's able to make some run stops. Because, yeah, those are two teams that barely give up sacks. But I do really like Christian Wilkins. Mike Dana has been pretty solid, too, but he's kind of all over the place. He's basically like an off-brand Jonathan Greenard. He either does really good, he's going to do really bad. Overall, I do think that the best two players Karen's husband does have is probably going to be your Christian Wilkins and then your Quinnen Williams. But I just think that when it came to the picking who I came or who I chose more over Karen or Booty, I just like Booty because I definitely would prefer Carl Granderson and Aaron Donald over any combo that Karen's has to offer. At least in my opinion, I think they just offer more consistency overall.
I could agree with Granderson. I don't know about Donald for me, but I'm also a little partial towards Dana because I'm a Chiefs fan. But yeah, Karen's just got three. I like to think of them as just really solid plug and play options. So Wilkins, like you said at the beginning, he really struggled, which is where Sealer shined, and now he's starting to kind of pick things up. Dana, he's got Chris Jones to kind of pick on the O line for him, so he can just do one on ones. So I think he's a pretty good fantasy option to have. But his only downside is that he's got a harsh schedule ahead of them.
Yeah.
And then, like you said, Quinnen Williams is a hell of a player. It's just they're going to put two, three guys on him, depending on if they run a three or four front. So it just kind of depends on the game plan for the week. But I don't know, yesterday, even though he's getting double teamed, he's still getting back there quite a bit. So if he can maintain that with the schedule he's got, I think he'll do fine.
Oh, yeah.
But I liked having the three consistent options over one really good option, in my opinion. So I have him ranked a little bit higher.
Alrighty. At the number eight spot is where I had Booty. I already said that. Who'd you have at your number eight?
I had Mills here.
Okay, so we can move right on to number seven. Seven's where I had Rictatorship.
That's where I had Karen.
Okay, so we're pretty close. Just a few mixes there. Number six is where I had Scrambled and Wiggle Waggled.
Me too.
Oh my god, I'm gonna come. Anyway, so a Scrambled Wiggle Waggled. Let me find him real quick. Let me find that motherfucker's head in a swing set. Anyway, Javon Hargrave. And first of all, let me just say he's done solid so far this season. He had the two bad games. Outside of that, he's been consistently solid throughout the whole year. But I do think people are going to be underestimating how much help Randy Gregory / Chase Young is going to be on the other side of that D-line. Just imagine all of the pressure that's going to come off of Javon Hargrave. Because imagine if, say, you're Quinnen Williams, a guy that's huge, big, and bulky. You know what I mean? I like big and bulky, yes. But anyway, Imagine the guy that's huge, big, and bulky, you know what I mean, is just stuck in one-on-one against the center. 9 times out of 10, Javon Hargrave is going to win that fucking matchup. His problem his whole career is that he's been double-teamed, kind of like Quinnen Williams. But when you have Nick Bosa and Chase Young attacking you from your edges, good luck double-teaming the defensive tackle. I think you'll see blow-up games left and right from this guy for the rest of the season. That's kind of a bold prediction I have for Hargrave. And then coming into Jonathan Allen. Jonathan Allen's kind of hard to say how he'll do with the loss of Chase Young, because this might actually kind of hurt him more on the flip side from Javon Hargrave. But overall, he has been boom or bust all season. He is known for doing that, where he has really good games, really bad games. I'm not too big of a fan of him rest of the season, but I will acknowledge that he has done solid so far this season just for his upside, but he's been inconsistent to say the least. And I actually think Zach Seiler is probably the better option over Jonathan Allen going long term. Both of these guys are pretty boom or bust, but Zach Seiler has been getting – he's been doing pretty solid against teams that actually have better right tackles usually, except for the Giants. He had a really boom game there. For whatever reason, whenever he's going up against someone good, he just does really good for no fucking reason. And the thing is, he does have a pretty friendly schedule coming up with Tennessee, the Jets, Washington, the Raiders. Outside of those last 2 weeks, because he's on the Dolphins, just like Christian Wilkins. And I do think this will overall be a pretty good set of defensive linemen for Scrambled and Wiggle Waggle, and I just preferred them over the other guys on the list overall, especially because of Javon Hargrave.
Yeah, no, he has a pretty solid set of three. Jonathan Allen, I think, is probably going to fall off a bit since he's missing Sweat and Young. But he's still a good player, so there's no telling what he'll make happen. Like you said, Javon Hargrave, with the addition of Chase Young, he'll probably just blow up for no fucking reason, because he's going to get a single team the rest of the season.
Mm.
And they mostly run a four front anyways, so that's even going to be – they'll be a little bit easier for him anyways.
Mm.
And then I like Sealer. Like I said, whenever Wilkins has a good game, he kind of falls off a little bit, but then whenever – Wilkins starts taking the double team, Sealer's got a single, and he can just kind of make whatever he wants happen. So I like him probably over Evan Allen as well.
Yeah, I think if Scrambled able to – if I were Scrambled, I'd try to use these guys to try to get someone a little more consistent for that second defensive line. But it's overall not a bad squad. I think it lands him in the middle of the pack. I just couldn't put him any further, because when you get to these top five guys, it's where you start getting consistency with upside, you know what I mean? Compared to all these other guys. So far, pretty much everyone on this list has been low consistency, high upside. And we're going to start gradually getting more in between, where we're going to start getting into more consistent guys that have the upside as well. At my number five spot is where I had Toxic Zenpai.
I actually had you here.
Fuck. I only had myself one spot higher. With Toxic, we'll kick things off with him. He has Myles Garrett. Myles Garrett is a fantastic option to have, one of the best in fantasy. If Max Crosby wasn't in the league, this guy would probably be the best defensive lineman in all of fantasy so far. But I will say there is one thing I'm not the biggest fan of when it comes to those 150 points. I do think his points are kind of inflated with the 2 weeks he had against Tennessee and against Indianapolis, where he had 45 and 36.75 respectively. I don't think you can quite rely on games like those, because, yeah, those are huge boom games. And he also did have some bust games as well, but he's still a fantastic option overall. I just don't think I could really rank him above guys like, say your Max Crosby's, your other guys that have just been ridiculously consistent, ridiculously good this season. Hell, I'd even probably take Cam Hayward over him. You haven't really seen the most of Cam Hayward yet. He's been playing partial snaps throughout both of the games he's been playing. But even then, he's still making a lot of tackles happen. But either way, Garrett's a very good option in fantasy, probably has insane upside every week. And I'm not really a fan of Chase Young. I don't really know what's going to happen with him, because I do think he's actually not going to have that great of a season. Because here's the thing, the Niners did go out there and trade for Chase Young. They also went out there and traded for Randy Gregory. That tells me that they're probably going to be switching snaps and splitting snaps between the both of them to keep them fresh and keep them healthy. In real life, that's great. That means there's a lot more pressure, and it's going to help the 49ers. In fantasy, it means you don't have nearly as many options to go out there and make plays happen. You know what I mean? So I just am not the biggest fan of Chase Young, but I do really like Brian Burns. He's always been one of my favorite defensive linemen to use in fantasy since he's been in the league. He's dealing with an injury right now, but all season outside of week four and week two have been really good. He's had at least 7 points in every game. He has his occasional upside games. He's known for being a run stopper, so he usually gets quite a few tackles. And overall, yeah, I do really like Brian Burns. I do think this is enough to warrant him in the number five spot. And hell, like I said, I only had myself ranked one spot higher. I actually was carefully considering which one I preferred between myself and Toxic. It was a pretty close matchup. Looking through all three of our guys, I actually think it was just a situation where I slightly preferred my third guy over his third guy, which pushed me over whenever I was doing my rankings for it.
Yeah, I ranked him quite a few spaces higher, mostly because of Myles Garrett. But I also have a different take on Young's new environment, I guess. I think it's definitely going to be, I don't want to say better for him because he was on a pretty good defensive line in Washington, but I think he's going to have more opportunity and less pressure on himself. I think, once again, like with we're talking about Hargraves probably going to get a lot of single teams. I think Young is probably going to get a lot of single teams too. I think a lot of teams are going to focus mostly on Bosa. But he's also a DN, so it's kind of hard to double team a DN, you know what I mean? But I think even with him swapping out snaps, I don't think they're going to want to focus on Young as much as we would think they would. But I also have I really like Brian Burns. If he was out right now, it'd be extremely helpful for Toxic. I'd probably put Brian Burns over Young just because he is the playmaker of that team. And he doesn't have too hard of a schedule going ahead. So, but that's just my take on it. And I had you ranked here mostly because Hutchinson's a little cuck.
Yeah.
And then I also had you ranked at five just because Hayward, like you said, he's just now coming in. He's not playing full snaps yet. I think once he starts playing full snaps and we're getting consistent 10, 15 point games just all around the boards, I think he'll definitely go up in the list. But I think as of right now, I think I can't rank you higher than five just because you don't have that third option that's playing, at least playing full snaps. And then Hubbard. I like Hubbard. Cincinnati's defense is really good. Him and Hendrickson are a really good combo to have.
Yeah. I like Hayward so much because he is probably the most consistent defensive lineman in maybe all of fantasy history. He's not the best option in all of fantasy history. He's probably the most consistent, though. He's the Steelers' main run stopper. The Steelers don't fucking use linebackers to stop the run. It's why they've struggled all season. In theory, they try to go get linebackers that are supposed to be good against the run, but it never works out. If Cam Hayward's gone, the run defense is just non-existent when it comes to Pittsburgh. If you watch any Steeler game, you'll see what I'm talking about. But with Hayward returning, the Steelers' defense is going to start becoming a lot better, I think, overall. And as he starts to play more snaps and starts to get healthier as the weeks go on, you'll start to see at least 10 points every single week, I believe. That schedule is looking ridiculously easy for him, too. The hardest offensive line he's going to be playing all season is probably going to be Seattle's or even the Bengals. But as you see what the Bengals like to do against defensive tackles, that ain't going to go too well for him. But either way, I really like Cam Hayward. I actually think he's comparable to Garrett. Maybe not in terms of the upside, but in terms of the consistency, he'll probably be better.
I would say so too. Once he actually starts playing, I'm just as soon as he starts playing, you move up on the list. Don't get me wrong.
And then there's Sam Hubbard, who outside of week two has been fucking fantastic all season. He's dealing with an injury he's had for the past 2 weeks. He probably won't be back in time for Thursday, if I had to guess. But either way, all season, he's looked really fucking good. He's been getting a lot of tackles. He's been getting some sacks. He's been getting, you name it, he's been doing it. At least like four tackles a game is what you'd want out of your defensive lineman. Very consistent. He has that sack upside. Once he returns, he does have a very nice schedule he's looking forward to, where he's playing against Pittsburgh. Baltimore's not going to be too easy if he plays against them, but he does have a very weak Jacksonville offensive line against defensive ends. He has the Colts offensive line who's weak against defensive ends, too. And it's the same thing. He plays Pittsburgh again. Kansas City might be a tough game. Minnesota, their whole O-line is fucking battered to hell and back. Everyone on that Vikings offense is just gone at this point. They might have the return of Jefferson, but their whole O-line is just hurt right now. And that schedule is looking ridiculously good. And then, yeah, Aiden Hutchinson is probably my least favorite defensive lineman I currently have. It's not because he's a bad player. He just almost gets to the fucking quarterback every single game 20 times and just never does it. I don't know if this guy's cursed or what, but yeah, it's definitely been a disappointing season, even though he has been. I think he's actually like above Max Crosby currently when it comes to QB pressures, but yeah, he never gets the job done, unfortunately, in fantasy. That doesn't really help out. I do think I definitely prefer him over Chase Young. That's what leaned me over the edge over Toxic. But I just didn't think I was warranted to be any higher on the list than four, though. Who'd you have at your four?
I had Mr. Steeler Girl here.
Oh, man. I had him at three. Or just one. Oh, no.
Yeah, I like Buckner and Parsons. I'm not a huge fan of Payne. I think he's a good player. He's kind of had some internal issues with the franchise as of late. And now that Young and Sweat are both gone, he's going to get a lot more attention. Plus, mm-hmm. he's got a really hard schedule. So I don't see him as a consistent third. But Parsons and Buckner combo is really – it's a pretty powerful combo to have.
I was actually extremely surprised this last week with Parsons. I don't know what the hell happened. He was going up against the Giants who – has given up like 24 sacks a game. I don't know what happened this last week. I don't know if they just put their entire fucking offensive line on them. I actually didn't get a chance to catch that game. But outside of this last week, Micah Parsons has been ridiculous. He's basically another Myles Garrett. His schedule's only going to get easier except for the final 3 weeks of the season. Then it'll get hard. But up until then, it should be a ridiculously easy schedule. He's been really good all season. He's pretty much Myles Garrett, but he is a bit more consistent than Garrett, which made me want to rank that aspect a little higher. Plus, I do think I actually prefer DeForest Buckner this season over Brian Burns just because of that injury history he's had, and Buckner's actually been one of the most consistent options in all of fantasy while maintaining the upside. Granted, you can argue, if you want to talk about a cupcake schedule, DeForest Buckner's had it. But if you look on this list, everything on this fucking list is green until you get to the Raiders. But as we all know, the Raiders' offensive line is not good either. This motherfucker has had a cupcake schedule, but it is showing absolutely no signs of shutting down or slowing down. So overall, very good option in all of fantasy. I think that's why I had Steeler Girl ranked at number three, just one spot higher. He's a ridiculously good option. Overall, I'm not a fan of Daron Payne. Like you said, I actually don't think he's even going to be very startable moving forward in fantasy. I just don't trust him. He was inconsistent as it was, and now everything going on with Young, the franchise, and Sweat, I just can't see it. I'm not a fan of Daron Payne at all at the end of the season. I think he's probably cuttable, to be honest.
Yeah, I think my only issue here with me having him a little bit lower than you is Parsons, because he's either getting 35 points or he's getting nothing. I mean, I bet you if we looked at this, just to answer your Giants statement, I bet you if we were to look at probably any other Cowboys lineman, they probably had 10 points because fucking Saquon couldn't get over 7 yards until the fourth quarter.
Yeah. I know Osa Odighizuwa only had 5. I'm not sure how many DeMarcus Lawrence had, though, because we were looking at the Osa Odighizuwa earlier, but he's a defensive tackle, though. I didn't actually get to watch that game. I'm actually curious because we know how bad the Giants offensive line is. I don't know what the hell happened to Parsons if he got like 5 people covering him every play. I actually have no idea, but
I don't know either,
to say the least. But
yeah, for me it's just the consistency with Parsons is why I have him ranked at 4.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I just think I preferred the combo overall over Toxic.
Yeah.
That's why I had him higher than both myself and Toxic. But it was only one spot higher. I do think there's a strong argument for 3 to 5 here between Toxic, myself, and Mr. Steeler Girl. I do think at least with me, 1 and 2 are kind of like a lock-in for 1 and 2. But that's just me, though. Who did you have at your
number three? I had Darth Malice here.
Oh, man.
Mr. Big Yawners.
Well, I had him at two. You'll be happy to know. We're just kind of
no,
wavering.
I think he's got three really good, solid players. He just doesn't have the closest thing to an outbreak player. He has is Madid Buk, or however the fuck you pronounce that. He's had a crazy season. I don't think anyone expected him to do this good. I like Ed Oliver. He's kind of picking up the slack from Rousseau. But like we said with him, is he's kind of got a tough schedule ahead. And then Hendrickson, I don't know if you know this, but he's getting MRIs today from his game. So he might – I don't think he'll be out for the season, but it's entirely possible that he will.
Yeah, it is worth mentioning whenever I made my side of the list, it was literally as the games were going on. So this was before Trey Hendrickson got hurt. So keep in mind,
they're thinking it's just like a Kelsey situation. They're thinking it's a hyperextension. But the fact that they're having to go get MRIs instead of just like they can't just tell like they did with Kelsey is a little worrisome.
Yeah, absolutely. I might have dropped Big Yawners a little bit after the injury. I didn't really think about it too much after it, but I did make the list before the games were over, though, before this injury happened.
This happened towards the end of the game.
If he does come back and he's able to be healthy the rest of the season, his schedule is cupcake outside of week 17 against Kansas City. And with all due respect, Darth, we kind of know you're not winning the Super Bowl. I'm joking. Trey Hendrickson. Trey Hendrickson has been that insane upside option that you said he kind of is missing now, but it's just a matter of if he can stay healthy. You know what I mean? If he can actually be healthy for these upcoming weeks. You've seen him in games where he's been up against mediocre offensive lines. I do want to point out in these last 3 weeks, he has gone up against the toughest parts of his schedule. Houston has their offensive line, who I know wasn't good at the start of the season, but they now are getting very healthy, compared to the beginning of the season where they were all beat up to hell and back. So Houston's offensive line isn't bad at all. Buffalo has a good offensive line, and San Fran has a borderline elite offensive line. So I do think that kind of explains his previous 3 weeks. But if you look at before the bye week, what he was doing to these teams that don't have good offensive lines, Arizona, Tennessee, the Rams, hell, even Cleveland, who does have a good offensive line, he was just shitting on them. You know what I mean? And he was being that upside player you were talking about. Now, he did have a bad week against the Ravens, but for whatever reason, Yahoo says they're ranked ninth worst in terms of offensive line. That's not true. The Ravens have a ridiculously good offensive line, specifically left tackle Ronnie Stanley, who Trey Hendrickson was going to be going against. It's the same thing. Outside of the Chiefs and outside of the Ravens, every single game this season is going to be a fucking cupcake for Trey Hendrickson. I'm a big fan of him overall. Justin Madueke is the definition of consistent. He had that bad week too. Since then, he's had everything figured out, getting at least 10 points per game. He's making it happen. He's getting sacks. He's getting tackles. You name it, he's finding ways to score fantasy points. He's been one of the most consistent options. For whatever reason, he's stepping up this specific season, and he's making it happen. And then Big Yawners also has Ed Oliver. Ed Oliver's definitely his worst option, I think, out of the three, assuming Hubbard or Hendrickson stays healthy. But he's not even a bad option, though. He's been going all season, having some good upside. He's just very inconsistent overall, and he is dealing with a lot of injuries. Other than that, it's hard to say how good he'll do when he comes back because he is going to be playing through injuries. He's kind of like the Cam Hayward. But either way, he's a pretty damn good option, pretty solid option. All three of these guys are very good. That's why I actually had him ranked at number two instead of number three.
I guess we'll move on to the number two spot.
Yeah, I was going to ask if there was anything you wanted to add to Big Yawners first.
No, I said my piece.
Alrighty. And then your number two is Toxic, I'm assuming.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, my number two is Big Yawners, so we can just move right on to number one. Now, before I mention this, when it comes to one motherfucker on this team, I don't give a fuck if the second defensive lineman was an Xbox controller or if it was a fucking Tootsie Roll. I don't give a fuck what it was. With Max Crosby, you're getting number one on this list, and it's not even close. Max Crosby is by far the most valuable defensive lineman from a fantasy point of view of all fucking time. It is ridiculous. He had a bad week this last week, but he was playing through an injury, to be fair. But Max Crosby is fucking stupid. He's the guy that has the upside, or he has the downside of everybody else's upside, while also having the upside of getting like 40 points every week casually. Yeah, he's fucking ridiculous. And keep in mind, this isn't even as good as he did last season. He did way better last season. This guy is just ridiculous. He finds ways to get sacks. He finds ways to get tackle for losses. He gets a lot of tackles in general. And yeah, there's just no fucking way anybody could even come close to this guy when it comes to fantasy. And yeah, Nick Bosa has definitely been disappointing, though. I'm not really the greatest fan of Nick Bosa, but for what it's worth, he has been doing pretty good over these past few weeks outside of the week against Cincinnati. And he has been kind of picking it up since the beginning of the season. I do think he's been disappointing for what you were expecting out of him, but he's still not a bad player overall. I do think he's still better than pretty much anyone else's defensive lineman past number five on this list. You know what I mean? And even then, he's better than most of the defensive line twos everybody else has. He would be a defensive line, I don't know what to call it, a DL1 on everyone's team, except for this one that happens to have fucking Max Crosby. So this is kind of stupid. And then I'm not gonna lie, I've been shit talking Montez Sweat since he got in Chicago. Not because he's a bad player, but in fantasy, he's pretty much useless at this point.
No, I'm hopeful that they figure something out for him. Because he was just so good at Washington. Like he got, I think, 119 points while he was there, and he's only gotten five since he's been in Chicago. So I'm hopeful they figure something else out for him. But I think with these two the rest of the way, I don't even need to put Sweat in at this point until Crosby has his bye week at like week 13 or some shit.
Yeah, I don't think they're really gonna. I don't think it's gonna be until next year. I do think the Bears are building their team to be long term. That's kind of what they've been going for over the past few years. But the thing is, the deadline's over. They're not really gonna be able to figure anything out at this point. At this point, I think the Bears are kind of trying to figure out who's
They'll
gonna
have
still
to
be on the
see.
team going forward and what they're gonna change going into the next season. You know what I mean? This is not a Bears team that's getting ready to make a playoff push and, hopes Montez Sweat gets 85 sack. This is a team that's trying to get Montez Sweat to help the rest of the D-line develop and handle single coverage so that way they're not getting bullied the entire rest of the year. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know. I'm just hoping they come up with some sort of scheme to get him involved, whether it's just D-line schemes or if it's rush schemes or blitzes or whatever they need to do. But I'm hoping he gets a little bit more involved than what he has been the past 2 weeks. Now, given that the first week he kind of, I don't even think he played the full game. I think he split snaps because he was still learning the playbook. But anyways, that's just my take on him. I'm hopeful. I don't have high hopes, but I'm hoping that he at least becomes a somewhat consistent player. Even though he is going to be the main threat on Chicago.
I think you have that game against Arizona. Somehow it doesn't matter if they put eight people on a guy, they find a way to get sacked by that guy. Arizona's just stupid like that. But on top of that, though. Even if he does start figuring stuff out, he plays Detroit twice. That's about the best defensive line you can go against in football, unless you're a defensive tackle. And even then, they have Frank Ragnow. Never mind. The whole defensive line, your offensive line, is just ridiculous. They play them twice. Minnesota, that should be a friendly matchup for him, but it depends on if they get him double teamed again, kind of like you've been seeing. Then it's Detroit and Cleveland. Those aren't very friendly. Atlanta and Arizona, if there is any time to use him, it would probably be those 2 weeks. But until then, unless he shows some sort of literally anything, this guy's going to be pointless in fantasy. There's probably way better options out there if you really need it. But
Yeah, I
top
think
three
this is
is
all
scary.
I actually needed at that point.
Yeah, this guy is basically our drop shot teammate. You have those hopes, but it's just never going to happen.
No.
And that's about it. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. I will catch you guys later for the defensive back video. It'll be me and my good buddy Pussy here. And then we'll figure out a way we can get that done after we upload this one. And I'll catch you guys later.